Thanks for coming. Today I will talk about BPF and Kubernetes. So first question, raise your hand if you have tried BPF. Maybe half of the room. And if you have tried Kubernetes, half of the room as well, I think. Yes, the same half. So my name is Alban. I did major contribution to the Container Runtime Rocket. And I like to work on containers and Kubernetes on systemd, on Linux, on BPF, and this kind of thing. I'm a CTO at Kinfolk in Berlin. And so today I will focus on showing use case of BPF inside Kubernetes. So I will not do a detailed technical presentation of BPF. There was already a couple of talks yesterday about that. But I will show example of different programs in BPF and how they can be used in Kubernetes. And I will finish with a couple of things we have done at Kinfolk to do tests on using Go. So first, short presentation of Kubernetes. I will just present what is necessary for the rest of my talk. So Kubernetes is a container orchestration. That means it's a system that will decide where to place your containers in your cluster. So when you deploy applications, you don't decide this pod go to these machines, but Kubernetes will do that for you. So in Kubernetes, there are a couple of concepts. A pod, that's a group, that's the smallest unit of deployment. A pod can contain one or several containers, and they will be deployed together on the same node. And then service, that's an important Kubernetes concept as well. That's done to address a service to when a pod wants to talk to another pod. Usually, we don't need to know the IP of another pod. We use the concept of service, like the front end can talk to the backend, but the pod doesn't decide which container to connect to. It will connect to the IP of the service, and then Kubernetes will route that for you using load balancing. This can be done using IP table or the dynamic, destination NAT on these kind of things. Introduction to BPF. So BPF is a bytecode that is executed in a Linux kernel. So we can say it's like a small virtual machine in the kernel that is safe to run, that will not crash your kernel. And it can be executed from different subsystems in the kernel. So there are quite a few I will show later. But to introduce BPF, I will take, as other people, the example of TCP dump. So maybe you have already seen this kind of schema before about the Linux networking stack. This shows an incoming packet on the network interface, and then Linux will route it, maybe route it to a different machine, or maybe route it to a local process. In this example, I have Apache, which has a socket, internet socket, and receiving the packets on port 80, for example. How does TCP dump works on that? So TCP dump intercept the packets very early in the network stack. So it can make a copy of all the incoming packets before any routing decision has been made. And how it works, TCP dump will create a socket of type AF packet, and Linux will make a copy of all the packets. TCP dump have more features. You can actually filter what you want to receive. You can say, I want only to see the packets on port 80, for example, or you can have more complex filters. So you cannot do everything, but still you can write quite a lot of complicated filters. In this example, you can even inspect packets to see if it is HTTP GET or something like that. To do that, a TCP dump will not manually check the packet itself, but defer that work to the kernel. So the goal of that is the TCP dump, the process doesn't need to be woken up for every single packet, but instead the kernel will run a BPF filter And that's a small program that will check in this example whether it's port 80 or port 22 or something like that. And then only the matching packets will be delivered to TCP dump. Okay, so that was an introduction on BPF for socket filtering, as it is used by TCP dump. But there are actually now a lot more different kind of BPF programs. There are here in this slide basically three categories: BPF programs for networking, for security, or for tracing. And for each category, there are different kinds. For networking, there is a BPF program for socket filtering that we have done in, that we have seen in TCP dump. Socket filtering at the C group layer, that's something new in kernel 4.10. And traffic control, that's to inspect packets very early in the network stack on layer 2. On some other usage of BPF programs is for security that we receive with LandLock. There was a talk yesterday on LandLock that you can see as well. And for tracing. So if you don't really know where the different BPF program of type networking are in this network stack, if you have seen this network netfilter diagram, the traffic control layer is very early in the stack. So for ingress packet, it's over there, and for egress packet is over there. On the socket filtering, it's very high near the process in the network stack here. In the rest of my talk, I will talk about different usage of BPF in different software projects around Kubernetes. So I will show different kind of BPF programs. We start with kprobe or curateprobe or tracepoint. That's for tracing. So kprobe is something that exists independently of BPF that exists before. That's a way to put a hook on some instruction in the kernel. So for example, every time a kernel function is executed, I can intercept that and execute some code. And with BPF, it's also possible to execute some BPF program. So with kprobe and curateprobe, I can execute some code at the beginning of the function, at the end of the function, and I can inject arbitrary code in a safe way with BPF. There is also a tracepoint, which is safer. That's for statically defined tracepoint in the kernel. I will have two examples of using that in Kubernetes. The first one is with the project Weavescope. Raise your hand if you know about Weavescope. So maybe 10%. So that's a project to view in a graphical way the list of containers you have on your Kubernetes cluster and to see the TCP connection between them. So in this screenshot, you see different containers and you see links. Each link represents the fact that there is a TCP connection between two containers. So you can see how they communicate and you have a global view of what's happening. To do that, they need to know the list of TCP connection. Before, it was done by inspecting all the list in process in slash proc, all the list of TCP connection in slash proc. That was not perfect, not efficient. And this new way to do it, use kprobe on eBPF. What we do is to put a probe on every TCP connect, TCP accept, TCP close, so we can manage a view of all the connections on the system. Another example of using kprobes on BPF in Kubernetes, still with Weavescope, this time using HTTP statistic plugin. So Weavescope has a plugin system to have additional view on the Kubernetes cluster. And this HTTP statistic plugin will show how many HTTP requests there is per second on different kind of HTTP requests or reply. For example, get, post, error code 404, etc. In this screenshot, you can see there was, for example, 115 requests per second, and you can see the graph. To do that, it will install some kprobs to on some kernel function. Every time a process send some packet over a socket or receive some packet, this BPF program will be triggered, and it will look inside the packet to see if it looks like a HTTP request or apply. Okay, so far I talk about kprobs. I will talk about a different kind of BPF program now for networks. First, how many of you know what is a queuing discipline or network scheduler? Maybe 30%. So on Linux, every network interface like ETH0 can be attached a queuing discipline. That's a network scheduler that will decide which packet to emit next when there is a lot of packets to emit. And you can decide the order on whether to delay or something like that. And when taking the decision, there is some special queuing discipline that can execute a BPF program for classifying the packet or applying some rules. And I will show two examples of using that in Kubernetes. The first example is still with Weavescope, with another plugin. It's called the traffic control plugin. What it does, it's installed a queuing discipline on every network interface for all the containers and apply some rules to, for example, add an arbitrary bandwidth limit or some delay, some latency for the purpose of testing your application to see what happens when some containers are slow, some network is slow, and to see what happened to your website from a UI perspective. So we have done some work on that, and you can check the blog post to have more information on how it uses BPF. So in the branch, in the master branch of this project, it doesn't use actually BPF, but there is some code to use BPF to filter the traffic. For example, all the traffic on port 80 will have some latency. All the traffic on port 22 will have a different latency, for example, for the purpose of testing. Another project in Kubernetes that use a BPF for network is Cilium. So Cilium use extensively BPF for network security. Cilium can decide which pod is allowed to talk to which other pod and apply complex security policies, including on layer 7. So they can look at the packets, see what kind of HTTP connection it is, and decide based on the URL whether to accept it or not. Cilium use BPF also for routing, so it will not use the traditional way of Linux to route packets between different network interfaces. It's all done using BPF. And if you remember at the beginning of my talk, I talked about Kubernetes services and that it uses NAT to pass packets to a Kubernetes service. Traditionally, it's done with IP table or netfilter using DNAT, but Cilium implement the same thing using with an implementation only based on BPF. Okay, another kind of BPF program is for security. There is a project called Landlock that you have probably heard yesterday at the talk on Landlock. That's not something which is ready yet. It's not merged in the Linux kernel yet, but that's an ongoing project. How many of you have heard about LSM or Linux Security Module? 60% of the room, maybe. So maybe you know SLinux or ArpArmor. Landlock is another one of them based on BPF. The idea is to have unprivileged sandboxing. So you don't need to be root to implement your sandboxing in your applications. At the moment, it's not there yet, but that's the idea. That's different than SLinux because you know the idea is you will be able to do that without being root, and that's different to second BPF. I will show next slide why. So here is an example of application that does the open system call on this file. So with a second BPF, you will just have access to the parameter, so that a pointer to a string on the flag here. And you seccomp will need to make their decision based on the parameter alone. Lonlog using BPF is a bit different because it can actually see which kind of kernel object. So for example, which struct inode or struct file or something like that. And it's all based on eBPF, so user space can upload a BPF program in the kernel and decide to apply this isolation for a specific process. So the question is, why could it be useful in Kubernetes? I have an example or an ID. That's not something which is implemented, but how many of you know about kubeless or about serverless framework? Maybe 3%? Okay. So I said before that in Kubernetes, the minimum unit of deployment was the pod. The ID in serverless or in kubeless was to deploy functions. So it's even smaller granularity. And by deploying function, we can hook that function on a HTTP request or hook that in Kafka or this kind of thing. But traditionally, containers isolate on the container level, not in specific function in a specific process. So I would like to see in the future if there was some kind of integration between Lonlog and kubeless to be able to isolate different execution of different functions in the same process. And the last kind of BPF program I will talk today is for socket filtering per cgroup. So that's a new feature in Linux in 4.10. That's a bit similar to socket filtering like for TCP dump, but the idea is to apply that on a cgroup. So many different processes in the same cgroup cannot have the same same BPF program that will filter the traffic. And then you can filter the traffic or apply some statistic there. What the kernel will do is for each packet, incoming packet or outgoing packet, find out which socket it is related to. And that socket belongs to a process which is in a cgroup, and it will check whether this cgroup has a BPF program attached to it. And that could be done for statistics. I would like to be able to gather statistics, specialized statistics in a Kubernetes cluster, and see for each container what is happening there. So how much traffic there is on port 80, how much traffic of this specific kind, etc. I think it will be great to integrate that in Prometheus, to have an exporter running on each node and gather statistics based on eBPF. And sending that to Prometheus to be able to inspect what's happening there. There is a kind of prototype that we have done on github.com/kinfo/cginet. That's not something really complete, but that can give an idea about that. I'm done with the giving example of use case. I will just mention a couple of tools. So BCC is a tool set to write BPF program in an easier way. And there is integration with Python. So you can write program in Python and use BPF from there. And And we have written another project called GoBPF to do similar thing in Go. So from your Golang programs, you can load BPF programs and apply them on different kind of for different kind of BPF programs. And finally, we have done some work to be able to test that. So on many open source projects, we use tools like Travis or CircleCI or Semaphore, that kind of free service to run CI on your project to test if each pull request, each commit doesn't break anything. For BPF program, that's a bit difficult to do that because often we need to have the last version of the Linux kernel, and quite often systems like Travis or Semaphore use all version. So some have a kernel 3.16 or something like that. So that's not really suitable for BPF tests. And a lot of them don't allow you to run things as root or with full privilege or to run virtual machines. But actually, there is one CI service that we have found, that Semaphore, that allows you to run things in the virtual machine, and they allow you to run nested virtual machines. We use Rocket. So I said before, Rocket is a container runtime, but it's not only about container. There is what we call stage one to run Rocket with virtual machine, with KVM instead of using containers. And with that, we use Rocket to launch an environment with a new Linux kernel version. For example, the latest released one, where there is all the BPF features. And then we run this on Semaphore. So you can test your BPF projects directly there. So if you're interested, you can look at the blog post over there. Any questions? Yes?
You did not mention performances. What happens when you start attaching BPF programs everywhere?
So the question is about performances. What's the performance impact when attaching BPF programs everywhere? I will say it's it doesn't have a lot of impact on performance because BPF programs are compiled first in a BPF bytecode, but then in the kernel it will be translated into the native architecture, for example ARM or x86 or something like that, and then it will be native code that is executed. So I think it's the cost of one function call. There is no context switch to different process or between user space and kernel space. So that's not too much. But I guess if you attach BPF programs for every system calls, that could still have some impacts. It's still less than tools like Strace. If you Strace all your process, that would be a lot more performance impact than using BPF. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.